All right. So hello and welcome. Thanks for joining this presentation. Today we're going to be talking about improvement of bicycle wheel CFD using blade element momentum. And the goal here is to reduce the computational cost of aerodynamic bicycle wheel design and analysis. My name is Andrew Vigne. I'm an undergraduate researcher here at the University of Central Florida. And this is my contact information. So if you have any questions about this research, feel free to reach out to me and I'll get back to you. I've been working closely in this research with my colleague, George Lubimov, who's a graduate researcher here at UCF, and also Michael Kinzel, who's a PhD and runs the Computational Fluids and Aerodynamics Laboratory here at UCF. So the cycling industry has been using the wind tunnel since the 1990s. A company called Cervelo, who you may recognize, has many bikes in the Pro Peloton, Tour de France, Vuelta, many pro teams. They invest hundreds of thousands of dollars per year on wind tunnel tests. And another company, Zip, who manufactures aerodynamic bicycle wheels, conducts 3 to 4 tests per year at 850 an hour for 85 hours. So if you do the math, just under $100,000. The point is these companies are investing large sums of money because aerodynamics is the core focus of today's cycling market. And this is because drag accounts for 90% of the cyclist's resistance at speeds over 25 miles per hour. So if you're racing, this matters. And cycling companies have to quickly respond to this demand for optimized aerodynamic products, which is where CFD comes in. And companies like Cervelo are using CFD all over the place because it's quicker and it's cheaper than wind tunnel testing. And it's a good flow visualization and design aid. However, it's still computationally expensive. In other words, high fidelity data takes a long time. So why do wheels matter? Well, wheels account for 10 to 15% of total aerodynamic resistance. Francesco Moiser demonstrated this by setting the world hour record at a pace of 31.8 miles per hour using disc wheels, like you see in the bottom right-hand corner. And even this year, the victory in the 2020 Vuelta a España was a margin of only 24 seconds after 73 hours of racing. And this was between Primoz Roglic and Richard Carapaz. So better wheels can reduce the total drag by up to 2 to 3%. So a 300 watt effort could become a 291 watt effort, for example. And improvements in between wheels can reduce drag up to 25%. And this is just down to how the wheel is designed. So you see an example of an improved wheel design by Zip, who uses ABLC technology to incorporate these golf ball-like dimples, which delay flow separation, hence reducing drag at high angles of attack. So the objectives for this research are to investigate the efficacy of a BEM spoke model. So we are going to apply BEM to the bicycle spokes to reduce the computational cost. Then we want to validate this model using experimental wind tunnel and CFD data, and eventually develop a CFD method of modeling bike wheels at a lower computational cost. So what is BEM and why are we using it? Well, blade element momentum is typically used for predicting wind turbine and propeller blade performances. It has a lower computational cost than other blade resolve methods. If you take a look in the bottom right-hand corner, you see these different approaches. On the far left, you have blade element momentum theory. And on the far right, you would have a direct numerical simulation. So that's actually meshing and defining your regions, your boundary conditions. So this is an artist's rendition, but the point is that the computational cost is hugely decreased by using BEM. So it requires a 2D airfoil data consisting of a range of Reynolds numbers and angles of attacks with corresponding CD and CL data. And we wrote a Python script coupled with StarCCM to gather this data. I will show you the methodology on that in the next slide. But BEM has never been used in this context before. It's certainly never been used in cycling. So can it work? Does it work? Well, We're going to be looking at one particular type of wheel. In fact, it's the wheel I showed you at the beginning of the presentation. Let's just go back and take a look. This is the head trispoke. It's an iconic wheel in the cycling world. It's known for its great aerodynamic performance. It has three spokes, full carbon fiber. It's based on an NACA 0012 profile with slight modification. So this is what we did. We took a cross section of that wheel. So this is a cross section of the spoke right here. We put that into SOLIDWORKS and we made a 3D model. So then run a 2D RAND simulation using StarCCM Plus, and you see the results of that here. It has an overset mesh, which rotates using Design Manager, macros and scripts, and it captures a airfoil polar, basically by conglomerating all of this data you see here. A lot of these plots are oscillatory because at past a certain angle of attack, you would be in the stall region. So we had to develop a way of averaging that data to develop these airfoil polars. And we used Python to do that. So once we got that data, you see the results of that here. This is the drag coefficient profile. This is the lift coefficient profile. You see at the critical yaw angle, it rapidly decreases, go to enters the stall region here. And this is all the oscillatory average data. And then once it hits 180 degrees or just about, it re-enters or it goes past the stall region again, and then starts generating good lift. Now, these are our boundary conditions. We're gonna be focusing on two airspeeds and two ground speeds, 20 miles per hour and 30 miles per hour. These are, you know, speeds you would see in a race, and it's also rich with experimental and CFD data. These are our solver settings. We're using a time accurate BEM virtual disk, and we've run some mesh refinement to make sure that we are on a converged grid density. Here are our current results. So the top blue line, that is wind tunnel data from Greenwell. The light blue line is from Zip Speed Weaponry, and that is also wind tunnel data. This light blue and this yellow line are from Matthew Godot. He ran a study, and this is used, he used DDES to solve this. And these are our results. We used Spallard-Armaris turbulent model. And of course, coupled with BEM. Now it starts to break down past this critical yaw angle attack, and we'll get into the reason of that later. You see that the model seems to be pretty consistent when the spokes aren't playing too much of a role. However, once the spokes start to play a role, the model seems to start to break down. Now, why is this happening? Well, let's take a look at the actual component forces. So on the left-hand side, we have the resolve method forces from Matthew Godot's study. And on the right-hand side, we have the data from our study with the blade element virtual disk. Now this is data from a critical yaw angle of 10 degrees. Transient results are averaged. Now, the biggest discrepancy here is clearly the spoke side force. And this is that dark red bar here and this very small dark red bar here. Now this is practically the blade element momentum methods basically producing no force, whereas the resolve method is producing almost 2 newtons of force. So huge difference there. And it's telling me, well, the model's currently not working as it is, at least to its full capability. Now, these are the streamlines, and we'll start to see why it may not be working. So this is 0 degrees, 5 degrees, we're starting to see some turbulence. 10 degrees, more turbulence. 15 degrees, just past that critical yaw angle. And now 20 degrees. So you see in this region where the spokes would be, you'd really if the spokes were actually modeled, you'd probably see some chopping as if they were chopping through the air. You get a high frequency wake that just isn't present when you use the virtual disk model. It seems to be almost averaged. And of course, we use the time accurate model, but there are options to do time average models. So that raises the question on what's exactly going on here. We've yet to figure that out. Now, if we compare these streamlines to Matthew Godot's streamlines, which are also from a transient study, as we discussed, you see this high frequency turbulent wake that definitely contributes to the drag forces. And especially with these streak lines, you see these high frequency shedding and these high frequency effects that just aren't present enough in the blade element momentum model that we used. Now let's discuss this. So the BEM drawbacks, they don't seem to have these high frequency wake, which otherwise would be caused by the chopping effect of the blades. So the current results overestimate drag coefficient past the critical yaw angle of 10 degrees. And this is most likely due to underestimating the drag forces due to missing these high frequency turbulences. So in future works, we're gonna continue to investigate an alternative low cost modeling method. We're gonna continue to investigate this BEM approach, see what's going on, how we can improve it. Does it work? Can it work? And eventually the large big picture goal of this project is to develop an algorithmic approach of optimizing aerodynamic bicycle wheel geometry using Python and Star CCM concurrently. So that's what I have for today. I really appreciate anybody who joined and stopped by. Feel free, like I said, to contact me at drewvine@neds.ucf.edu if you have any questions. Thanks again.